In the sweet by and by,
we shall meet on the beautiful shore.
By and by,
in the sweet
by and by,
we shall meet on the beautiful shore. We shall sing on the beautiful shore the melodious songs of the blessed, and our spirits shall sorrow no more. Not a sigh for the blessing of rest.
In the sweet by and by,
we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
By and by,
in the sweet
by and by,
we shall meet on that beautiful shore. To our bountiful Father above, we will offer a tribute of praise for the
sweet
by and by,
by and by,
we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
By and by,
in the sweet
by and by,
we shall meet on that beautiful shore.
I'm kind of homesick for a country to which I've never been before. No sad goodbyes will there be spoken, for time won't matter where my faith will end inside. There's just a few more days to labor, and then I will take my heavenly flight.
I'm truly thankful to be back at Calvary. And as I was driving here this morning, I was asking the Lord to bless in terms of a safe return from Oklahoma, and Lord to help Pastor with his foot, help the church and her ministry. And so glad to have a chance to be back with you. Very grateful for Pastor Kennedy's and Angels Fellowship, and for the fellowship of the church. And it's just a joy to be back here to fellowship with you and to minister the Word of God, and praise the Lord. Joyce would have loved to have been here and shared the special music. And Billy, thank you for that wonderful hymn of worship. Joyce is teaching the children's church at Tabernacle this morning. She does that on a rotation of about once every 4 or 5 weeks. So this was her Sunday. She would have been here. And thank you again for your kindness and for the warm welcome. I have mentioned the service to our grandson Walter at Caswell Developmental Center, and I'm going to tell him how to. I wasn't sure it was live stream or not. I think he might be trying to listen in about now, but I'll tell him it will be recorded, and that he can hear the service later. But hopefully our grandson Walter will be listening in. I want to say hi to him and to the other residents there and the staff. And just so good to see you and be with you. And Roger, I do appreciate this water. Thank you. Excuse me. I brought 4 books with me today that you might not be too familiar with. This is called The Only Book God Ever Wrote, and it's all about the inspiration of the Bible and how to use the Bible in our daily lives. And it gives proofs for the Bible's inspiration, has a chapter on how to handle Bible difficulties. I think you'll find it interesting. I taught this material years ago in the early years of Pensacola Christian College, and would love to share it with you in book form. I did this book when I was teaching at Piedmont. It's called From Babylon Unto Jerusalem. It's a handbook on the entire Bible, and it goes through every book of the Bible and gives chapter titles and favorite verses, introductions to the books, special studies like how you can find Christ in the Old Testament, what to look for when you study Bible archaeology, just a number of subjects. And so we got copies of that back there. And then we have the companion volumes, The Lake of Fire and The River of Life. Already shared copies of those with Timmy. When Timmy told me he was almost through reading one of the books and would read those, I got kind of excited. But they're companion volumes. The Lake of Fire deals with the doctrine of hell and talks about the apology, that is the intellectual defense of the doctrine. Gives 15 reasons why a God of love and justice must send people to hell who reject Christ. It's a devastating doctrine, and we need that encouragement to understand it, I think, better. It also has a section called The Agony, which talks about what the sufferings are like of people in hell right now and what the Bible warns about. And it has a section called The Appeal, what the doctrine of hell should mean for those who are lost, what the doctrine of hell should mean for those who are saved, and the missionary burden that's connected with that. And then the book on heaven is The River of Life, and it goes into detail about what heaven's like and what we'll do when we get there, and description of New Jerusalem. And I tried to answer in that book a lot of questions that our students have about what heaven's like and what the Bible teaches about it. So those books are back there on the back pew, not too far from where Timmy is in the sound booth, and they're available on a donation basis. Love to have you look them over. Books have the plan of salvation on the back too, so you can share them as a witnessing tool. And if you want to know where I got the title From Babylon Unto Jerusalem for the Bible handbook, just ask me afterwards. Open your Bibles, please, to Acts chapter 2, verses 41 through 47. Acts chapter 2, verses 41 through 47. How can you tell if a church is really a church. By the sign at the front entrance of the building, by the cross on the steeple, by the ringing of the bell, by the stained glass windows. I had a pastor friend back in 1993 who preached a sermon, and I think it was at the beginning of the year, looking forward to the new year. He preached a sermon, and I love the title. He called it My Dream Church. My Dream Church. And I'd like to bring a message today on My Dream Church, going back to what the church was like in the earliest days in Jerusalem with Pentecostal fire, and talk about what is God's dream church and what's God's dream for this church. And so our text will be Acts 2, 41 through 47. And here's our outline. They continued together, and they continued together to grow. Simple outline. They continued, verses 41 through 43. Then they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayer. In the Greek, the idea is they continued in the disciples' apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and then the breaking of bread and prayer are two great examples of the fellowship. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. Then the next point in the outline is they continued together, verses 44 and 45. And all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men, as every man had need. And then our last point is they continued together to grow. They continued together to grow, verses 46 and 47. And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. Notice, first of all, the early church in Jerusalem continued, verses 41 through 43. And they that gladly received his word were baptized, and the same day there were added unto them about 3,000 souls. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, and in breaking of bread and in prayers. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles. When the law of truth was given, 3,000 people died. When the gospel of grace was given, 3,000 people were saved. Remember when the law was given back in Exodus, and in connection with the golden calf apostasy, where the people turned away from God, and the Levites went through the camp and executed some 3,000 idol worshipers. That was at the beginning of the legal dispensation. But now that we have come to the beginning of the age of grace and the church age, we see that at the beginning, 3,000 people were not executed, but 3,000 people were saved. And I think that one way to explain this is in the wondrous words of John 1:17. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. Now, Jesus tells us in connection with the parable of the lost coin in Luke 15, 8 through 10, likewise I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. If you're here today and you're lost, and you accept Jesus Christ into your heart as personal Lord and Savior, I don't care whether the streets of Norfolk are dead right now, or whether the streets of Norfolk are filled with celebration because of some kind of an event or a parade. I don't care what's happening in Suffolk or Virginia Beach. I don't care what will be on the national news. I don't care what will be happening in different countries of the world. But if you got saved this morning, God will put all the business of heaven on hold, and they will celebrate and rejoice because your salvation means so much to heaven, as it should mean so much to you. There is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. Now, if there's so much joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth, can you imagine the joy when Peter preached on the day of Pentecost and some 3,000 people got saved? I'll tell you, that must have been joy unspeakable and full of glory. Now, at Calvary and the Tabernacle, we believe in a doctrine called believer's baptism. We don't believe the Bible teaches that an infant should be baptized. We believe that infant dedication is a wonderful thing, where parents, with the help of the church, commit their little ones to God, that He'll bless them and help them raise them aright. That's a very good thing. But we don't believe that a little baby should be baptized. We believe that only when a person comes to personal faith in Christ and is personally born again, does he then, as an act of obedience, follow the Lord in believer's baptism and identify with his people and make a public testimony of his faith. And I believe this is the way it was in the book of Acts, verse 41. And they that gladly received his word were baptized. I believe that's the biblical order. You believe, then you get baptized. The first college ever formed in America was Harvard in 1636. And her first president was a fine man named Henry Dunster. But as he was president of this Puritan school, over the 12 years of his leadership, as he studied the Bible, he became convinced that the Baptist doctrine was the true doctrine and that only believers should be baptized. And you guessed that he got fired. In fact, it even got worse. He was prosecuted because he would not have his little daughter infant baptized. But we believe believers' baptism the way they did it in the early church. And as the founder of Tabernacle always liked to say, winning is just the beginning. Dr. Bell would say, winning is just the beginning. We read in verse 42, and they continued, after they gladly received the word and were baptized, they continued in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayer. A preacher back in England in the 1800s, Alexander McLaren, preached a message on verse 42, and he entitled it, A Fourfold Cord, A Fourfold Cord. They continued in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayer. And as Solomon said in Ecclesiastes 4, a threefold cord is not quickly broken. Well, here's a fourfold cord that is not quickly broken. That is true of churches like Calvary. Before each one of the items in the Greek, there's a definite article. They continued in the apostles' doctrine, in the fellowship, and in the breaking of bread, and in the prayers. This is one reason why I think the breaking of bread here refers to the Lord's Supper, because they would break bread from house to house as part of their regular fellowship and meeting. But here I think it's the breaking of bread, and it talks about the importance of the Lord's Supper in the early church. But notice this fourfold cord. This church at Jerusalem had love for the word, love for one another, love for their absent Lord, and love for prayer. Notice first the love for the word. they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine. I don't think this is as true in independent Baptist circles now as it was back in the 60s and 70s. I am, by God's grace, an independent Baptist. But I think one of the real problems with our movement, especially back in the 60s and 70s and 80s, was a lot of people had the notion that an ideal pastor was something of a cross between a wheeling, dealing, supersonic salesperson and a powerful corporation CEO. You bring people in, you get big numbers, you develop all these ministries, and the pastor's largely a CEO who governs it all, and people who get with the program, that's fine, but if somehow if they don't fit too easily or they have special needs and they don't fit, we're better off without them and we'll easily replace them. There was too much of that mindset, I think. And when people thought of what an ideal pastor would be, too often, they thought that he would be a cross between a supersonic salesman and a wheel-and-dealing corporation CEO. I don't want to be unkind, and I'm over-making the point to make the point. But what kind of a pastor does God want for a church? Well, I think he tells us in Jeremiah 3:15, and please don't get me wrong, I think it's good churches grow and they have new ministries if they keep everything in proper perspective, amen? And don't forget the importance of every person. But God tells us in Jeremiah 3:15, I will give them pastors according to mine heart. Well, what's the heart of God when he gives a pastor to a church? He says, I will give them pastors according to mine heart, which shall feed them with knowledge and understanding. Now, I'm aware that the context is Christ's rule in the millennium. I'm aware that pastors here or shepherds are not talking about local church ministers, but people who will rule with Christ in the millennium, political realms, religious realms, commercial realms. But I think it certainly applies to what the New Testament tells us about a shepherd of a New Testament church. What's a pastor after God's own heart? He's someone who feeds the people with knowledge and understanding. And when you have a pastor, like Brother Kennedy, who loves to feed you with knowledge and understanding, continue to value him. For Paul said in 1 Timothy 5:17, let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they that labor in the word and doctrine. And the early church continued in the apostles' doctrine. John Milton wrote centuries ago in England, and this is sad. He said, the hungry sheep look up and are not fed. But Paul said to the Ephesian elders on the island of Miletus in Acts 20, 26 through 28, he said, wherefore I take you to record that I am pure from the blood of all men. For I have not shunned to declare unto you all the counsel of God. Take heed unto yourselves and unto the flock over the which the Holy Ghost hath made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he hath purchased with his own blood. So they had a love for the word. They also had a love for one another. They continued in the apostles' fellowship. The early church at Jerusalem had what someone has called the quality of togetherness. Horatio Nelson explained one of his greatest victories by saying, I had the happiness to command a band of brothers. Well, they also continued in love for their absent Lord. They continued in the breaking of bread. Whenever you participate in the Lord's table, it should help you a lot in your outlook. If you remember the four looks, there is the backward look. This do in remembrance of me, as you remember what I did for you at Calvary. The cross of Calvary, the Christ of the cross, is the foundation of all of our hopes
and the fountain of all of our joys. But there's also the forward look. For as oft as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show forth the Lord's death till he come. We look forward to that time when the Lord's Supper will merge into the marriage supper of Lamb once we arrive in glory through the rapture. And then there is the inward look. But let a man examine himself and so eat of that bread and drink of that cup. You have to make sure your attitude towards the Lord and towards one another and towards the Lord's ordinance is proper and reverent and loving and unifying. And then there is the outward look. As we're told in 1 Corinthians 10, we all partake of that one loaf. We all partake of that one cup. Speaks about the unity of our brothers and sisters as we share together in this wonderful ordinance that binds our hearts together in a common salvation. And then there's a love for prayer. They continued in prayer. It's been said that 7 days without prayer makes 1 week. W-E-A-K. After Peter and John were threatened by the Jewish Supreme Court and told not to teach or preach in the name of Jesus, they came back and shared their burden with the local church and they prayed. And we read in Acts 4, and when they prayed, the place was shaken where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost, and they spake the word of God with boldness and with great power. Gave the apostles witness of the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. We read in verse 43 that fear came upon all the church. Now, we read in chapter 5, verse 11, after God had a serious church discipline matter he had to take care of with Ananias and Sapphira. And great fear came upon all the church and upon as many as heard these things. And as God continued to bless at Jerusalem, we read in Acts 5:13, and of the rest durst no man join himself to them, but the people magnified them. People were afraid to join the early church. We're afraid if they don't join. But when God adds them, it's wonderful. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved, verse 47. So we read that the early church continued, but then notice in verses 44 and 45, they continued together. They continued together. And all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. All that believed were together. They took advantage of all occasions to meet. Wherever you saw one disciple, you would see many more. We are his sheep. And sheep like to flock together. Christians are like ticket stubs, on which you read, void if detached. A Christian who is not part of Christ's church is something like a student who will not attend classes. A soldier who doesn't obey orders, a citizen who doesn't pay his taxes, a salesman who has no customers, an author without readers. Thank you for what you said to me. A parent without a family, a bee without a hive. Now, I had the privilege 1 week to lead a series of revival services or Bible conference services at a storefront church on Bragg Boulevard that ministered to many of the people at the Army Fort. And it was Thursday night, and I was going through the creation week. And the last night we were supposed to deal with the seventh day, the day of rest, time to focus on the Lord. And I wanted to whet one of the members' appetites, Sister Butler. And
So I thought I'd whet her appetite on Thursday night by saying, tomorrow, the last night of the revival, I'm going to preach on one of Pastor Green's very favorite subjects. Well, I was going to talk about the need to set aside a day and how we set aside the Lord's Day in the New Testament and we worship Him and focus on the things of God. I was going to talk about the importance of attending church, which, as a pastor back then, was very important to me, and I think it's important to a lot of pastors. It's important to the Bible. And so I told Sister Butler, I'm going to preach on one of Pastor Green's favorite topics. I was going to emphasize the importance of church attendance. That's what I meant. But when I told her that, a strange look lit up her face. And she was so puzzled. And she asked me, she said, "You're going to preach on fried chicken?" Well, fried chicken was another one of Pastor Green's favorite subjects, but I was talking about the importance of church attendance. They continued together. There was a dear pastor visiting inactive church members, and he was trying to impress upon them the importance of how important it is for them to be there and take part. But the man just couldn't see it. And so they were sitting before a blazing fireplace, and the minister had an idea. He got up, walked over to the fireplace, removed one of the flaming logs from off the fire, and laid it aside. And it wasn't long before that log, the fire went out, and it became kind of an ashen gray. And the man at the house got the idea, if we don't burn brightly together, our fire will quickly go out and will be cold and dull. And that's what Hebrews 10, 24, and 25 says in so many words. It says, "And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and good works." Oops, I'm sorry. Once I was preaching in a church in Moncure, North Carolina. Sorry about that, Pastor. And I nervously gestured and knocked a glass of water off the pulpit. I was preaching on the overflowing Christian life. And on the way out, pulling out of the parking lot, driving back home, my oldest son said to me, "Well, Dad, tonight your cup certainly did run over." But in Hebrews 10, 24 and 25, it says, "And let us consider one another to provoke unto love and to good works." Now, I know some church members can be very provoking and irritating, but that's not what that's talking about. It means stimulate. We're to stimulate one another. Old English word, it means stimulate. We're to stimulate one another unto love and good works, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together, as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another. And so much the more as you see the day approaching. Now, whether that day was the fall of Jerusalem in AD 70 or the second coming or poof, the idea is, I think we're not far from the coming day when our Lord will come back. And we need to be gathered together and encourage each other in these times in the light of the Lord's return. And we must not forsake the assembling of ourselves together. We need each other to encourage each other and sharpen each other. Proverbs 27:17 says, "Iron sharpeneth iron, so doth a man the countenance of his friend." There was this Christian dad and this little boy, and one Sunday afternoon they were kneeling at the little boy's bed having a time of prayer. And the little boy prayed and said, "Lord, we sure had a good time at church today. Wish you could have been there." Well, he was there. And that's why they had such a good time. Jesus said in Matthew 18:20, "For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." Now, the rabbis in Jesus' time had a rule that you could not form a synagogue, a synagogue, a gathering together, unless you had 10 married men with children. Jesus said, "You can gather together in my name without any requirements like that. You can gather together if they're just two or three. You You don't have to be a man, and you don't have to be married. You don't have to have children. Whatever, two or three gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. They can celebrate my presence and rejoice together. And, it's so important to meet in Jesus' name. Revelation 2:1 says Jesus walks among the seven golden candlesticks. And I believe what that means is every time you and I come to church, Jesus is there. And he wants us to have a personal encounter with the risen Lord. Thomas missed so much when he missed that first Sunday evening service on Resurrection Day. And it's hard to tell sometimes what you might miss if you're not at God's appointed place, at God's appointed time, in terms of what he has there for you. So they continued together. And our last point is they continued together to grow. They continued together to grow, verses 46 and 47. And they continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. I believe in these verses we have at least 10 traits of a tremendous church. 10 traits of a tremendous church. Notice their constancy, continuing. Their fervor, daily. Their unity in one accord. Their audacity, I use that word in the sense of boldness, in the temple. Their hospitality from house to house. Their familiarity, they did eat their meat. Their alacrity with gladness, their sincerity with singleness of heart, their doxology, praising God, and their testimony, having favor with all the people. Is it any wonder that the next words we read are, and the Lord added to the church daily, such as should be saved. Wherever there is inward vigor of life, there will be outward growth. When the disciples did their part, continued with one accord, God daily kept his part of the agreement and added to the church. Dwight L. Moody testified, strife is Satan's strategy. There is one thing I have noticed as I have traveled in different countries. I have never known the Spirit of the Lord to work where the people are divided. There is one thing that we must have. We are to have the Spirit of God work in our midst, and that is unity. We must, as Paul tells us in Ephesians 4, endeavor. You got to work at it. Christian unity should come natural because we're all part of one body and brothers and sisters, and yet, and all the challenges of ministry and all the different personalities and all the ways we interact and every different idea we have as to what will work or what won't. We have to work hard to maintain the unity God gave us when he saved us. We must endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. A great preacher in England in the 1800s told his congregation very bluntly, "Depend upon it, brethren, that far more than my preaching, your lives will determine the expansion of this church. And if my preaching is pulling one way and your lives the other, and I have half an hour a week for talk and you have 7 days for contradictory life, which of the two do you think is likely to win in the tug?" There was in this elementary school a teacher who announced to her all children, "Tomorrow we're going to have show and tell, and we want each of you to bring in something and tell us about it that is connected with your religious faith." And so a little Catholic boy brought in a rosary. A little Jewish boy brought in a yarmulke. And a little Baptist girl brought in a covered dish.
The early church enjoyed getting together with food for food and fellowship and fun. We read in Acts 2, 46 and 47a, and they continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. Life in the early church reminds me of our Lord Jesus' early life in Luke 2:52, where it says, Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man. Life became an anthem of praise and a psalm of thanksgiving for those who had been delivered from the power of darkness and translated into the kingdom of the Son of God's love. They did break bread from house to house, and they'd eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. The early Christians in Acts loved one another with a pure heart fervently and loved to gather together around the great things of God daily. The joy of their salvation overflowed into every detail of their life, gilding the mundane with an aura of glory. I think of what Solomon said back in Proverbs 15, 15 through 17. All the days of the afflicted are evil, but he that is of a merry heart hath a continual feast. Better is a little with fear of the Lord than great treasure and trouble therewith. Better is a dinner of herbs where love is than a stalled ox and hatred therewith. To be able to eat in love makes the meal 20 times more wonderful. They were one family and lived as such. Surely then men did eat angels' food, and on platter and cup was written holiness to the Lord. I love the way the book of Zechariah ends in Zechariah 14, 20 and 21. When we were reading about the garments for the high priest, this high priest, the spiritual leader of Israel, who alone could go into the Holy of Holies one day a year, he had a golden mitre, and inscribed on the mitre were the words, holiness unto the Lord. And it was very special. It was part of the garments that only that high priest could wear. But the time will come in the millennium, according to Zechariah 14, 20 and 21, where even on the bells of the horses that ride down the street will be inscribed holiness to the Lord. This is a way of saying all the details of everyday life is going to be caught up in a sacred purpose. That happened in the early church too. And God wants it to be that way in your life and mine. As Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Holy Christ-like living is a magnet that will draw people to us. In Ephesians 4, 15 and 16, Paul says, but speaking the truth in love, may grow up into him in all things which is the head, even Christ, from whom the whole body, fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplieth, according to the effectual working and the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. If we will be what we ought to be as a church in terms of quality, God will bless that quality and give growth and will increase quantitatively as he sees best. In verse 46, they continuing daily with one accord. Verse 47, the Lord added to the church daily. One of the greatest ways to win the lost is to love the saved. One of the greatest ways to win the lost is to love the saved. Jesus put it like this in the upper room. He said, a new commandment give I unto you, that ye love one another. As I have loved you, that ye also love one another. By this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, if ye have love one to another. When Joyce and I first came to Tabernacle some 23 years ago, we noticed all the different people, the different ministries, all the different interaction, all the different personality, and wondered, how can we best fit in? How can we do our part? How can we make a contribution? So many gifted people you can appreciate and draw upon. You'd like to have a part too, but you don't want to bump into somebody and get into his way and interfere. How do you function in a ministry like this? And I feel God led me to pray this prayer. And I pray it not only for Tabernacle, but I pray it for Calvary this morning. Here's the prayer. Lord, help us to grow together. And together, help us to grow. Lord, help us to grow together. And together, help us to grow. And as God helps us to do that, we'll be more like the way it was in the early church. Pastor.